3, 2, 1, and we're live. Welcome back, everybody, to chapter 15 of our Coriolis game. With us tonight, we have Walter Peck playing Nassir, we have Slit playing Thurayya, Dem playing Ali, and last but not least, we have Zypher playing Pasha Khan, dapper, handsome, and ever the smooth talker. But first, before we get started, Dr. Linzetto looks out through transparent glass. He sees his reflection distorted by tiny courses of raindrops as they wind their way down the glass to the ground, then pool on dirty steel. The rain follows the laws of nature, the watercourse way, as some mystics call it. Linzetto pushes his glasses higher on his nasal bone. He licks pale, fleshy lips. But we few lords and rulers are destined to improve on what the icons have provided for us. Praise be? How could it be any other way, he thinks. He looks through the acid rain to a mountaintop and a giant communications dish and antenna. Below, dug into the mountain, is a factory. He listens to the thrum of automata and sees dark smoke belching into the air. The doctor continues to think to himself, smug and haughty words filling his mechanical mind. And, dear icons, I have known your number since the beginning. There can be nothing new under the stars without sacrifice. And Algol, sadly, will be a most worthy offering. The scientist is roused from his revelry. A soldier is over his left shoulder.
I am sorry to disturb you, Dr. Linzetto. There is news from the Midlands. Control Tower Omega 536 is down. At first we figured it was due to the savage microclimate that particular piece of hardware resides in, but after a few days of investigation, we feel it was destroyed on purpose, sir.
Linzetto turns, his fleshy mouth agape.
Accelerate our plans.
Algol's immune system is making one last defense before its death rattle. The scene fades out over snow-topped mountains, tinged brown and black by the soot being belched into the air by the factory. And the camera fades higher and higher through gray clouds, brown clouds, and finally into the deep dark of space, where hang a multitude of twinkling silver stars. Powered down to essential systems, in low orbit with its cloaking system turned on, is the Crimson Wish. And on board of the Crimson Wish, after several days have passed, we find the crew. We find Pasha, Thurayya, Nassir, Ibrahim, Ali Tarek, Hakim back in the engine room, and Mikhail Nineflowers from Planetside, all on the bridge, discussing plans on what to do next.
Oh.
And you can hear me? Yep. Can you see?
Uh-huh.
Yep.
I thought that we left off on Algol while we were, Nassir and Thurayya were in the, Pasha were in their hidden complex. Did I miss something?
Several days have passed. Unless you want to go back and roleplay something there.
Can you remind me how that ended?
So Pasha kind of convinced the people from Nasir's old village to throw in with them. If you remember, the older folks really didn't have a taste for conflict. But some of the older, younger folks wanting to regain their freedom and being fed up with the consortium's activity kind of threw down the gauntlet and agreed to help you guys out as far as your cause went, and then it kind of ended that way.
Okay, great, thanks.
And what I was going to do is kind of go through and kind of talk to you, and you let me know kind of the things you would have done in the days since then. Now, it ended that way, and there was one last scene when Pasha Khan did send a message to Aladdin, Pirate King. He sent that transmission. It wouldn't be a real-time communication, obviously, but it ended with a cutscene with Pasha recording a message to the Pirate King. Does that refresh everybody's memory?
Yep.
Yep.
You want to start, Slip?
I think Thurayya is concerned that the disease here is going to spread faster than they'll have medical supplies to treat. How could we get this formula for the antidote out to some place that's close enough that it could deliver? Do you think we could send this to Aladdin? Would he have access to the facilities to get it made in time to treat many people?
That is a good question, Thurayya. Let us consult these notes that Hakam left. Bo, when he created the vaccine, did he get more information on what's the gestation period?
It's pretty quick. It's deadly within a couple days, he said. And it starts showing symptoms within hours. Very quick moving. And you have not necessarily a vaccine, but a kind of an antibody therapy, a treatment if folks are already sick, not anything
to look at it. It's not a vaccine, it's a treatment.
No.
Well, all the more reason that we need to get a lot of it.
The planet of Algol, it has known for its industrial capabilities, not so much its medicinal. I suppose in the cities, the hospitals could produce the antibodies, but they are under the control of the consortium. We would have to somehow gain control over a facility like that to produce it in large enough numbers.
Yes, that is correct. Bo, would you say that maybe this is better. That is correct. Pasha is sitting there looking at everybody around the table. Kind of the room is like one of their board rooms. There is like a large table in the center, almost like a war table. On the table itself, there is like a 3D projection of Algol. You know, the parts of the surface are important to everybody in the room, not the entire planet, because that would be too much. While Pasha is looking around the table over the past few days, based on his understanding of the data cache that Nassir, Thurayya, Ali, and Hakam had brought back, and based on Hakam's insight into that and his ideas, Pasha has started to release some of that information to various news outlets all over the horizon, surreptitiously, with like I'm a no-name good do-gooder who brings you this information kind of message. Different parts of the data cache have been disseminated to the various news authorities. Does that way, when the news breaks, it doesn't look like it's a single source, but multiple sources reporting on what's happening in Algol. That way, if one news source is shut down by the consortium, somebody else will pick it up. And the more they try to shut down the news sources, the more it will seem like a conspiracy or something large is unfolding.
Let's do a quick scene between Ibrahim and Pasha. As you know, you have your speeches written, your data there on your tabula, but Ibrahim is going to have to hijack the communications from Algol and get this message down to the planet and also into the interstellar relays. And so you approach him near the communications center one day and tell me how that goes.
Yeah. You know, Ibrahim's kind of hunched over the console. He's working on some program that he's been talking about, how he can waylay a security around a pretty popular lottery system on Dabaran. It's a scheme he and Pasha have been running for a long time, trying to figure out how they can get their hands on billions of beer without anybody knowing, siphon off a few from the top and make their way along the horizon into all the vastness that and vastness of pleasure that the horizon has to offer. Ibrahim.
Captain Khan, at your service.
You still playing with that program of yours?
Yeah, it's not perfect, but it's getting there. A little tweak here, a little tweak there, an extra line of code added, one removed. Every little bit helps, you know.
Yes, patience is a virtue the two of us share if our plan is to come to fruition. We also, after all, need a retirement plan, don't we?
Absolutely. I would like to grow old on a planet with rivers, pristine white beaches, wind blowing through my dark locks. I do not want to die here on this barren landscape. Though Nassir may love this place, I have seen much better environs that are more suitable for Ibrahim al-Fashir. And dare I say yourself, Pasha Khan.
Of course. Yes. I do not understand Nassir's love for this, but then I do not understand Nassir's love for getting his face in situations where it ends up being stamped on. But then what do I understand about people?
The Midicurges can do wonderful things these days. His face keeps getting prettier and prettier each time it gets beaten up. But don't tell him I said that. Now, you wouldn't have come here just to chit-chat, Pasha. I know you are a man of action. What can I help you with? How are things going with your communication and, shall I say, information campaign?
That's why I'm here, brother. It's time that we gave the consortium a dose of their own medicine. While they believe disinformation and disenfranchisement of the people is how they can bring worlds to an order, I believe the truth, given in the right doses, in the right places, can bring about the right amount of chaos to upturn a upstanding group like the consortium.
Everyone serves someone. And the public never knows how much power they had if only they turned en masse against the authorities. I suppose that is our job.
That is right, my brother. The public does not know their own power. They need something to always wake them up from their stupor of the daily grind, of the little things that they worry about. They often too scared to look up and seize what is theirs. That is why people like you and me, we do well. We do well because not many people want to take the risk. But you anger the public enough, you outrage them enough, and all you need is a spark and they will explode all on their own. Spontaneous combustion.
Do you have a spark, Pasha Khan, or do you have a flamethrower? Give me the details.
I have both. I would like to be everywhere and nowhere at the same time. These are four data sticks I have prepared. A few of them are flamethrowers, a few of them are small sparks, and one of them is just a smoking gun. The idea is to spread them across the horizon. Different news outlets, and here's a list of the news outlets I've prepared as well, based on my research. They are not beholden to the consortium. And they are not easily swayed, at least that's what the people believe. If they start reporting these packages that are prepared for them, very soon people are going to ask what is really happening in Algol. The consortium won't be able to hide it for much longer. I do know at my time on the Coriolis station that even the people of Coriolis do not like the meddling and the heavy-handedness of the consortium. That's the thing, you see, Ibrahim. When you try to be a dictator, when you try to crush the little man underneath your boot, you have to be extremely sure that you never let up on the pressure. And this is us releasing the pressure.
I'll see what I can do. I know you've spent some time on this, but I'm going to also need to spend time. In order to get the necessary signal to go interstellar, it's going to take a small act of wizardry. I will check back with you soon, Pasha Khan.
I have full faith in you, Ibrahim. You are the wizard I'm looking for. Take your time. I would rather it be correct and slow than incorrect and fast.
All right. So I think the way we're going to do this is everybody's going to kind of describe what they've been up to, what their plans are, and then we're going to make some rolls with modifiers to see how things turned out, and it will kind of say, like, you know, what support you get on Algol, whether the Pirate King comes, what's the kind of interstellar hubbub and opinion like. But I want to wait to do the rolls until we've kind of heard from everybody narratively, if that's fine.
Fine by me.
All right, so like Ibrahim's probably going to do a data gen. I don't think he'll have any mods just yet. There hasn't been anything that's going to really necessarily help him. Pasha Khan, you're going to do a manipulation, but it's going to be with the +2 because I think you have a favorable circumstance because you have this information about the disease. Okay, so I'm going to say Ibrahim is going to do data, Pasha, manip. +2 and let me resize your tokens, and then we'll move over kind of narratively to Thurayya, Nassir, and Ali, and what they've been up to. I know Nassir and Thurayya and Ali, I guess there's some talk on the channel about trying to find additional villages to come over to the cause, trying to find cache of weapons and that sort of thing too, so I'll let you guys take it away.
Thurayya, you know, is helping to find the other locations where people are, but she's also been starting from the data they've gotten from that data cache, trying to locate the main hub of the consortium here, and getting as much information as she can about that, whether from people they've met here, you know, native Algolians who might, you know, have been brought there for some reason, or just guesswork on layout based on what they can find from the outside. It sounds like Ibrahim is probably, and Hakam are maybe a little busy to do some hacking in to get schematics, but that might be a goal. But for her, she's getting as much information as she can based on observation and trying to do it stealthily.
I think if you narratively, it would be kind of helping you in their off time and give you a +2. I think if you kind of would describe that in your role play, like how that would work, I'd be down with that. So you're kind of scouting, right?
She's taking the shuttle out and locating both places where they think people are living and this the main hub of the consortium. She will take the shuttle out to a, it's a distance where she thinks that it won't be noticed, send the drone out scouting, find their antenna, where they, in their communications arrays or whatever they're using, and entrances, and try to determine how the security there is laid out, how people are getting access.
I think with that probe plus Ibrahim, a plus two is totally fine. Observation, I guess.
Okay.
She would want to use something else.
Nope.
On some of these forays out into the tundra too, like probably Ali and Nassir would be helping you. But let's hear from them, hear what they would be doing.
So to fight a war, you need two things: motivated individuals and lots of guns. So Nassir would most likely, one, be assisting Thurayya, kind of in the scouting department, maybe focused more on recruiting the tribes and clans of the wastelands that have never truly been under the thumb of the consortium. And then also he would be looking for where some of these mines are, where the indentured servants or outright slaves were being sent to. Because most likely they would be motivated to not only be freed, but to fight against the people that were enslaving them. So once the recruiting was done from the various pools, both the tribes and the miners, then he would be looking, along with Nine Flowers and Ali, of weapon caches, of any place that is a target of opportunity in terms of getting equipment, both personal and larger, to fight the upcoming battles against the consortium.
Sweet. Okay. So yeah, at some point, Mikhail catches Thurayya and Nassir on their way back from one of their their scouting missions, and they have just kind of come in from the airlock, and that opens, and Mikhail is there, like, next to the war table. You guys come in, and maybe you're covered with snow, and like the moisture is kind of dripping off of you as you start to get warmed up. How are things going, Thurayya and Nassir? Have we found weapons? Have we found more willing to fight for our cause? Our scanners show this place is nearly barren. But as we know from your old village, Nassir, the denizens of Algol are resourceful indeed.
We have seen some returns on our ventures. I believe that finding people who want to fight is not difficult, but giving them the motivation via weapons and rifles and armor, that is proving to be more difficult. A good carbine is tough to find in the taiga forest, where they might be a little bit easier to find in a armory of some kind by the Colonial Agency or the Consortium.
I see. An armament does not hold up well in this climate either. I suppose most of such things have been confiscated by the Colonial Agency. It is much more easy to dominate the population when they are disarmed.
Very true. One of the first things to do that they did when they came here was disarm the populace. It is easy to extend your control over them when they have no real means to fight back.
Very well. Oh, and by the way, Thurayya, Hakam called up from his workstation. He had like a word with you at some point. He says he's engineered a upgrade to your probe sensors.
She raises an eyebrow. That is interesting. I did not ask him to, but it is a welcome addition if it works. I will go speak with him. But perhaps, she looks at Mikhail and Nassir, we can locate where they are storing some of these weapons in our search as we look for their for where the consortium has consolidated their strength. If we can liberate some of the weapons, she kind of shrugs, perhaps that would inspire more people.
An excellent idea. The more we resist, the more will we that will join our cause.
She nods and says, I will go look for Hakam.
Excellent. Me and Ali in 9 hours will continue to pore over the maps and see if there's any locations we have not checked yet that we might find people willing to help us in this rebellion.
Giving folks sight on Occam's token. Okay. So Nassir, how about a +2 obs for you for finding the weapons hatches? Is that cool?
Yes, sir.
All right. And everybody see workstation?
I do not.
I see it.
Just move tokens.
Now I do.
That's fine. That's fine.
Thrice in the hammock, I see.
As you walk down to the mechanics bay, before you even open the door into his workroom, you hear the sound of machinery and sparks and servos. And as you walk in, he kind of turns to you and he has what looks like to be a welding shield over his face and kind of flips it back up. And that blue white light from his arc welder kind of extinguishes itself.
Oh, Thurayya, I'm glad you could make it. I've had some extra time up here in orbit and, well, I don't want to be outdid by my family on Coriolis, so I made you these.
He kind of holds out a module for your probe.
She reaches out curiously, takes it, kind of examines it. It is to improve the sensors. In what way?
You can adjust it. It can either pick up electromagnetic frequencies or heat signatures, infrared or electromagnetic waves otherwise. You'll be able to see what's coming before it even gets to us.
That could be very useful indeed. What is the range on this?
He looks at it and scans it. Like he kind of opens up a hatch on this module and digs in it.
Oh, around 30 meters or so.
Ah. All right, so for close, when we are close to the enemy then, but we cannot see them. Good, this will perhaps come in very handy here. That was thoughtful of you, Hakam.
I'm the thoughtful type. What do you know? Spent enough time with an AI and, no, you just want to start helping everybody, just like Ashanti.
Well, perhaps, although our med lab is limited in resources, perhaps we can produce as much of that medicine as we can. I'm sure that we will have need of it in the future.
I'll do what I can. We pretty much exhausted all of our supplies. Between you and me, Thurayya, that was a miracle that even happened. Very unlikely. But hey, that soldier is counting his blessings, eh?
Yeah, she nods. Is there a galactic entity like the Red Cross? Like a do-gooder organization that gives humanitarian aid?
I guess. I bet in that thick book of Coriolis is probably... A lot of times there's religious sects associated with the different icons. And I think there's one of the icons that's kind of like that way, like a Mother Teresa type. So, yeah, there's something like that.
Yeah, she starts thinking about that. Perhaps we can get word of this formula to someone who is in a better position to manufacture it. But thank you again, Hakab. I am going to install this right away. And yes. She looks down at the module with the kind of a little bit of girlish excitement and turns around and walks out, headed toward the area where she kind of keeps her stuff to get her probe out and install it.
So you just mark that down on your sheet, that it, you can use one of your action points to either tune it towards electronics versus infrared spectrum. And it will give you a +2 on obs rolls using that probe on top of whatever you would get otherwise in those particular circumstances.
Okay.
His talent pool is useful. I just didn't want to not use it in this session, so. All right, last but not least, Mr. Ali Tarek.
That sounds like everybody's quite busy. So Ali would split his time helping anybody who needs help. And then anytime you get on the ground, when they supply weapons to people, he'd help teach them how to use them. A quick course.
Okay. Let's see. So you're training up any villages that have thrown in with you guys?
Yeah.
Let's just call that a ranged combat check. Well, it would be command, but you don't have a very good role in that.
Yeah.
Command roll with a +2 since you have help.
All right, that works.
Okay, let's see what order this stuff would go in. All right, let's do Ibrahim and Pasha first.
Can we add to that getting the, I mean,
yeah,
how can I make that the same role to get word out to, like I said, some sort of humanitarian organization to get this cure manufactured?
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. If they're successful, I think because of that, they're going to give everybody else bonuses to their checks on top of what you already have, if that makes sense.
Yep.
Because that means that I keep saying inner the galaxy, but the Third Horizon's kind of public opinion would shift over the course of days. The opinion on Algol changes, and you have to think that the high-ups in the agency and consortium down planet side are in communication with, you know, the powers that be, right? So, all right. So, Pasha Khan, manipulation +2.
Hold by. Manipulation +2.
Ooh. Wow. Got it. Just barely. And let's do data.
Ooh.
Yep. So with that humanitarian stuff on it, Thurayya, spotting and convincing the villages, you'll get an extra +1. So that would be a +3 for you. And I'm going to say that will be another one for Ali as well, as morale is improved. Since Nassir is just trying to find weapons, I wouldn't give him a bonus for that. So Pasha, kind of tell me how Ibrahim slices into the networks and get this message out to the Third Horizon and down on Algol, and tell me how the public opinion starts to shift.
So there are about 4 major news outlets, but what Pasha had Ibrahim do at the last moment was he got an idea in the Baron and one other planet that I can't remember as a player. There were 2 major sporting events actually happening at the time. And the broadcast of that was being pushed worldwide. So he asks Ibrahim to slice into those two broadcasts and actually send out a couple of videos from the data cache. One video would be just this large-scale production facility where automatons are being built, and another where Al-Fashir is being concocted. And with the video kind of zooming out, he makes Ibrahim add some over-the-top CGI to kind of make it look like it's all happening on Algol. Once those two are injected into the data stream for those sporting events, people watching that would suddenly see their screens flicker out. One of those like, oh, sorry for the technical difficulties with that ping, sound followed by like these graphic images of stuff happening on Algol for about 30 seconds. And then right back to that technical difficulties followed by just dead air. Right? Like he just cuts the broadcast so that people are just stuck watching blank screens and what they just saw. So it gives them a time to think about it before the broadcast fixes itself. While that is being done in parallel, he sends these data packets to four major news networks, which cover Coriolis Station, the Baron, parts of the Demon Star, surrounding planets, not just Algol, and sends them information on the movement of money. The consortium has been amassing all sorts of resources on Algol. And he keeps it very mysterious as to why they're doing it. He doesn't release information about that alloy. He also sends them images of the slave trade, people being killed, mass graves, and all of that with key names. And he makes sure that Narosha's name is not there, Nimrod's name is not there. No higher-ups' name is there in those reports, but like maybe, mid-level managers, not directors of directors, mid-level managers, their names and bank account information and stuff like that. Like that just shows a lot of money's been moving. Yes, Ibrahim, this is excellent.
And there's a cut scene as that feed kind of cuts in and you hear an announcer say, "And more news out of Algol. There have been reports of harsh labor and treatment conditions of the natives there, and even rumors of a deadly plague. Now, Consortium and Colonial Agency authorities have denied these complaints so far, but our men on the ground have confirmed that this footage seems to be accurate and real. There have also been reports of small rebellion and sabotage on the Demon Star. Stay tuned for more information on this breaking condition."
And there's also a cutscene of Dr. Lamon Lanzetto in his office speaking with the head of the consortium. And you can only hear one end of the conversation.
"Yes, madam. Yes, I am aware. No, I do not know how they obtained this footage. No. Yes, yes, I know there was rumors of a data breach days ago, but the men in charge have denied this, and these are top men, top men. Yes, yes, I am aware of the cost of failure, but failure is not an option and is not something that we will experience on the Demon Moon. These pests will be exterminated like these dirty natives themselves. Goodbye." He hangs up the phone.
Thurayya, your turn to make that roll, and roll those beautiful sixes. The plus three.
All right. Only one.
You can still reroll and keep that one. Let me see how many dark side points I have. I have zero.
Yeah. I think information's pretty critical right now, so I'm gonna pray to the icons.
There we go.
Yay.
Nice.
Okay, so yeah, she's been spending day and night, hardly sleeping, flitting from place to place, scouting, asking questions of, you know, the people that they've been able to locate, looking at readouts from the ship of heat signatures and whatnot from the planet. And she's found things here and there, little outposts, little settlements, little fortifications, supply depots maybe, but nothing big. But just as she's about to really kind of give it up and go get some real rest, hope that something turns up and maybe some more of the data cache. She turns her shuttle around and pulls her drone back and just catches something, some electromagnetic signature from the new sensor, just on the very edge of its range. So it must be very, very close to that drone, but it's just on the very edge of its range. She just gets a flicker. She almost misses it. And she kind of blinks at her tabula. Was that real? Was that perhaps his sensor is malfunctioning? And she very cautiously sends that drone forward again toward the direction where she thinks that flicker happened, and it happens again. And she sends the drone up and forward, keeping it in as much cover as she can until she gets a good read on what she found. And when she looks at it, she a broad grin spreads across her face and her eyes close with an expression of relief, and she says, "Praise the icons, thank you," and gets as much data as she can safely and pulls the drone back and excitedly gets on the comms once she's close enough to the ship. Actually, she probably wouldn't do that. They don't want to get picked up, but she'll tell them as soon as she gets back on board.
Yeah. And I can give you more information on that too, if you want, on what you kind of pick up.
Great.
Some computer stuff for your probe. There we go. Sounds kind of probe-ish. So as that probe flies in the air, you're about to turn home, and you pick up a quick burst of electromagnetic waves, of radio waves, coming from just over the horizon. As you send the probe back over, you get a visual on this thing. This base kind of tucked in between two large cliffs, a valley, kind of recessed down into a mountain, and you see a large communications dish and an antenna as well. But the strange thing is that that electromagnetic pulse, as soon as it starts, it just kind of shuts off. And you must surmise that there must be some sort of invisible Faraday cage of sorts to kind of keep this base cloaked. But then every once in a while, when they need to send a signal out, they'll just send a short burst of radio waves, and that's how you found it. So you can report that information back. I think with that rule too, you have found several other small settlements.
And I think with that intelligence provided, that that will give a Nassir an extra plus one on his roll. So he's up to plus three as well. So any other role player, I'll let you get to it.
Yeah, she returns to the ship, docks the shuttle, and jumps out, you know, unstrapping as quickly as she can. And she kind of, she gets on the comm. She says, "Everyone into the command center. I have news." And as people get there, she takes her tabula and she, you know, kind of connects it to the main display somewhere on the ship. She starts flicking images forward of this place, all the readouts she's getting, and she says, "We found it. This is it. They had it shielded so that it was very difficult to detect, but just by chance, just by luck, just by perhaps divine intervention, I caught a flicker of one of their communications." And she starts turning the visual kind of around in a 360 around the place so everybody can get a good look at it. And then she also starts saying, "And I also found several more settlements." She kind of posts their locations and approximate sizes up on a map on the display.
"This is excellent news. Well done, Thurayya."
Yeah, she is still beaming from ear to ear, and she says, "Now it is just up to you to convince these people to fight."
"It is up to us to convince them to fight. That installation there will be our target. We want it to go up in flames, yes?"
She nods, like, enthusiastically. "Very much so."
"Then the flames shall be the beacon for the people of Algol. They will draw to it like moths to a flame. It will light up from here all the way to Coriolis Station and will signal the start of the fight. The freedom of your people, Nassir. The freedom of this planet."
"Indeed, that is excellent. Finally, we'll be left to our own devices."
All right, this is a good order, because if depending on if Nassir finds a bunch of armaments, then Ali will get even more bonuses, or if he doesn't, then Ali will get penalties. So, Nassir, how did the search for weapons go? Give me the roll.
Let's find out. With plus three. It went okay.
Pretty good.
Enough for a plus one, I'd say, for Ali. So tell me how that went.
As he searched the fringes of Consortium-controlled areas, from his past experience fighting against them, he knew some of the most likely areas that they would be storing weapons, ammunition, supplies, things that they would quickly need to get out to their various armed forces. And he knew how to strike, and he struck hard and was able to gather enough supplies to give a respectful amount of weaponry to those willing and wanting to fight against the Consortium and their dastardly plans.
So Mikhail and his men kind of accompanied you to this outpost. It was probably very lightly guarded, if guarded at all. And so you kind of fell upon it, catching them unawares, and we'll just do a little kind of cutscene as the guns are flying and men are dying and whatnot, and Mikhail says, quickly to the door, set the charges.
As they do, Nassir is giving suppressive fire against the Colonials and anyone attempting to
stop them from their target of their raid, covering as the explosives are set in a giant explosion as the barrier is ripped from its hinges and track, exposing the interior of a warehouse just full of crates and tough boxes of carbines, rifles, grenades, armor, everything a growing rebellion needs.
After that's over, you're left with about 12 prisoners who, seeing probably 50 of their men and women killed, there's 12 of them left, they hold up their hands and they surrender. What do you do with them?
Are they native to the planet? Are they just the Colonial Agency? No. What are they? Them trying to remember what the armed forces of the Colonials are?
No.
He leaves the decision up to 9 followers. He goes, "We did not take survivors or prisoners or anyone who surrendered when we fought the first time, but this is a decision for you to make. I would not carry this dead weight."
Yeah. Nine Flowers looks to his men and says, "Take pictures of this place in shambles. Take pictures of the dead. Spread it to the villages that still remain in the mountains. Show them that we have the strength to overcome the Colonial Agency and their masters in the Consortium." And then he just aims his weapon at them all, and blood just splatters all over you, Nassir.
He looks impassively
ruthless
as they die.
Later that day, you arrive with several shovels, and they're full of Mikhail's men and women, and you start to, at one of the mountain villages, unload armament, and Ali is there waiting for you, probably surprised on how much you got. That's enough for a plus one, so I think you'd be up to, what I say, a plus three now?
It'd be four.
Four?
Yep.
Oh, yeah, because you got a morale boost, too. You got plus four, so I'll let you do the scene of Nassir bringing back all the weapons and stuff.
It looks like they were holding out on us.
As, you know, various carts are brought in just to the brim with equipment, Nassir has a big smile on his face and kind of looks down to his blood-splattered armor and he goes, "Do not worry, this blood is not mine. It is indeed, it seems they were holding out on us or perhaps planning for some major push into the highlands, but we got to it first and will put it to much better use. Tell me, how goes your training with those recruits?"
Yeah. Lately they've been eating a lot of dirt, but these weapons will help us. Hopefully they learn how to shoot.
Eating dirt and shitting freedom, I like it.
All right, make me that command roll with a plus four. Here's the deal. Okay, you succeeded with everything. You only had one with flying colors. You got the location of the place, which is good. So I'll let you role play it, and I'll kind of tell you what the estimation is about your forces and whether you think you'll be able to take this maneuver or not. But Ali, I'll let you kind of role play what the training looks like and stuff.
So, Ali's standing in the middle of the field watching as people are crawling around him and learning how to clean and fix up their weapons, newly found weapons. And he'll make his way over to the range. Look around as you know, he has little helpers as they're kind of walking. There's some emotions. This won't do. You guys are struggling against your own weapons. trusted weapon to fire, trusted weapon to hit the people, trusted to defend you. For if you don't, you will fail. And if you fail, the one next to you will fail as well. As you are not fighting for yourselves, you are fighting for each other. If you're not going to fight for your brother next to you, he won't fight for you, and then you'll get nowhere and your families will all die. If you think that your families are safe if we fail, come in again. The Consortium will hunt you down. The Colonial Agency will hunt you down. All your families are at risk. Regardless if you fight or not, regardless if you live or die. Take your shots between breaths on the exhale. Let it do its work. And yeah, just sit back and watch him, hopefully for an improvement.
You see a young girl, probably the age 14, Ali, kind of at the end of the line. She's firing and the recoil is nearly knocking her out of her boots. But she has grime underneath her eyes. Her eyes are tear-stained, not from fear, but from anger. You get the sense that this girl is willing to fight and die if need be. But she is just not handling her weapon well. How do you approach her?
Ali would walk over to her. Yes. It looks like there's a lot going on here. Do you think the weapon is too strong for you?
Yeah. Yes, it is. This weapon is half of my height. But no matter. If I can take one of these dogs down with me, I will consider my part played in this war.
Hmm. Yes, I see you have determination. There is dread behind those eyes. And you'll kind of kneel down. The weapon is bigger than you, half your size, weighs half your weight, and it kicks. So what do you... You have to do something to mitigate that. You don't have to stand and fight. Lay down. Use the ground. Let it hold your weapon for you.
She, you hear the crunching of the snow as she kind of gets down on her hands and knees and then plants the butt of the rifle against her shoulder, looking down the sight, keeping both eyes open, and she pulls the trigger. Several shots go through the center of the target, and she looks at you with wide eyes and a big smile, a few missing teeth.
And that'd be one of the dead dogs. There are many more to follow that target.
She gives you the old action movie nod and sets about finishing her practice.
Yeah, Ali. Ali would not leave her side. He'd keep talking to her, words of encouragement, giving advice with a smile on his face.
Might just kill her, just make everybody sad.
Noble sacrifice.
It's war. So at one point in a few days, let's say all of you guys are down there. You guys are like far away, out of any scanner range, hopefully, so you can do this training and kind of looking down at all the forces. It's not all of them, but a fair number. And Mikhail Nineflowers is actually surprised.
Oh, my. I did not think you could do it. I said it once and I'll say it again. The icon smiled upon this planet when the Crimson Wish entered orbit. We will not leave this fight without blood spilled on both sides. We will lose men and women, that is a fact. But now, I do not feel so hopeless. I feel with the information gleaned and moving swiftly and public opinion on our side that we have a chance. We really do.
So, out of character, you guys have enough, do you think, you know, if nothing else bad happens, to win the fight, not with heavy casualties, but with significant casualties. I'll let you guys kind of role play. What do you want to do next?
If we carry the day and it seems that we are going to win, I feel like we should take the head off the snake, so to speak, with this director that has been the thorn in our side for so many weeks here.
Yes, I agree. If she is on planet, then we know where she is.
Yes. Get her and give it to the people. Let them have the reward.
It would be a fitting end for her. She wanted to destroy them only for her to be destroyed by the very thing that she sought to profit from and to immortalize herself. Perhaps she will be immortalized in a different way as the person of the consortium that lost Algol for good.
Pasha Khan.
I just want to clarify, what is the facility that Thurayya found?
It's basically the place, they're building something big.
Okay.
It's basically the spot, it's the Death Star of the operation. It's the Nexus communications hub, it's where the scientist is, it's where the big factory is, it's where probably that big drill is.
So while you guys are exchanging those words, Pasha is just sitting there looking at the images that, you know, Thurayya found, and he's kind of superimposed those on top of the Algol relief map, and he seems to be lost in thought. Yes. We attack the base. And we hold it ransom before we destroy it. I think there is a way your people, Nassir, can make a lot of beer to kickstart this whole planet again on even footing. And at the same time, destroy the consortium and take out the detector.
How can you be sure that the consortium won't just bring in ships to destroy it from orbit? They'd rather sacrifice the director and the facility rather than be held hostage and have it exposed for the horizon to see.
Change scenery for you guys since you've been in that place for so long.
It is starting to smell. Let us have a drink in the mess hall.
Yes, yes. We all move to the mess hall. Pasha is sitting there with a drink and his favorite hookah pipe. He's smoking and sending smoke circles into the air. I do not believe that the director Narosha is on the planet. He wouldn't be so close to the action. If I were her and a strategist, I would want to keep my distance, but at the same time profit from my actions. Right now, with the campaign that I've set in motion, bringing down the good name of the consortium all over the Third Horizon, they will have too much on their plate. It would arouse even more suspicion if consortium ships start moving through the gates towards Algol, ships clearly designed for warfare. No. Somebody as large as the consortium with the resources they have would believe that this thing can still be settled, that Algol could be still theirs, that something, someone could turn the tide for them. And this is where my plan for a double cross, I think, would work. We still have the information on Narosha, on her trying to line her own pockets. We can negotiate with her, tell her that I am deceiving my crew and the people of Algol. That if she comes here with a billion beer, I will hand over Algol to her, for I know all the plans and the information that would make her look bad in front of the rest of the directors. That's a strong enough carrot. And the stick is our possession of that installation. She will come. She might bring a small force to bear down on us. But when she does come with that money and we do capture her, not only will your people find a way to gather their recourse for all the atrocities done upon them, they will also have a billion beer in the coffers to rebuild Algol as you and your people see fit. That is my plan.
It seems... Nassir takes a big drink. It seems risky, but you have not led us astray yet.
It is risky. But it's no more risky than what we're anyway attempting. We will attack the installation and we need to take it over. And then we will lay the trap for her. We have to. She has to come here willingly. If she disappears, because she would have the resources to disappear, then all of us would be looking over our shoulders for the rest of our lives, and I do not think that is what we would want. No. We need to make her feel powerful, in command and control. She may have lost the beach, but she would still needs to believe that she has the planet. I will make her believe that. I will make her believe that I am just a pirate looking for a payday, a hefty payday, and I do not care who I double-cross. That's what I will make her believe. And she will come here. I'm sure she will come with a force, just in case, and I'm sure she will try to double-cross me. But that would be no different from any other director coming here to trying to squelch the rebellion. It's just that here, your people can make some money. And if the Pirate King Aladdin has received my message and has taken the bait, he will come here as well. I do not know whether he'll come here to trade or fight by our side, but either way, when he comes, if your people have money, then they can find solutions to most of their problems. Food, water, medicines, weapons, building material. He can bring all of that. For a billion beer, your people can trade.
A billion beer is a lot of money, Pasha Khan. She is kind of looking at him. She's had her feet kind of crossed up on the table, but she puts them down, not quite so relaxed, and says, all of my instincts tell me not to trust anyone when a billion beer is on the line. But I am choosing to trust you, Pasha Khan.
Yes, a billion beer is a lot, Thurayya. But think about how much the Consortium has already invested in Algol.
No.
Think about the weapons they have moved here.
I am choosing to trust you, Pasha Khan, that you will not betray us for a billion beer.
Therein lies the fun, isn't it, my friends? I will let you think about it. I will not force you into discipline. Can you trust me? Can you trust me not? It is hard to say. In the end, each of you will have to make that decision. But this is fun nonetheless. And you can see, like, Pasha is like fully relaxed. He's smoking his hookah. He's drinking his drink.
At that point, Ibrahim calls down to the galley.
Captain Gunn, incoming hail. It seems to be Aladdin Pirate King. He has a pre-recorded message. Would you like it to send me to your tabula?
Pasha just looks at everyone with this like wide smile on his face. Right on cue. No, not to my tabula. Put it on the main screen.
Very well. Patching it through.
See here. The old hologram shade. On the main screen appears Aladdin, Pirate King. And on his right-hand side is Shahina Kassab, one you know and love. Both of them look steely-eyed, and Aladdin relays you a pre-recorded message.
This is Aladdin Pique of Enos, captain of the destroyer Kingfisher. We have just exited the gate on the Algol system. We should arrive to the planet in 3 days. I expect a warm arrival, Captain Pasha Khan, followed by more beer than I can count, or Shahina can count, or my onboard intelligence can count. We will work together and be the richest men and women in the third horizon. I will see you in 3 days. In the meantime, I trust your leadership. Aladdin PK, Shahina Kassab, and Destroyer Kingfisher, out.
And the signal cuts off.
Pasha leans back in his chair, puts both of his feet on the table, smiles at the rest.
Well, at least we are not alone in this.
It seems we will have a little air power to go with our ground assault.
If you want to wait, this is the choice that's posed before you.
How many people does Thurayya estimate might be in that base? Like, was she able to pick up any data?
Yeah, there are a good number of people, but what's more formidable are the defenses. There are, you know, lots of soldiers inside. There are soldiers on patrol. There are kind of anti-personnel turrets surrounding the place. It's very hard to jam it because it's shielded by that invisible Faraday cage. There are air-to-surface weapons or surface-to-air missile-type weapons. It's a formidable target, but you'd be able to take it according to, you know, calculations and how many you have, and the fact that moving quickly, it'd be a relative surprise.
Pasha kind of puts his feet down, gets up from the table, and kind of walks a little, almost to the head of the room.
Can't make it that easy for you guys. You have to make a decision.
He looks at them. If I remember correctly, it wasn't too long ago that the very people in this room were with me when we infiltrated an asteroid in space. One could say that was many moons ago, or it feels like just yesterday. We can wait on Aladdin, but if we use too much of his help, he will also ask too much of us when the time is right.
I hesitate to wait. The consortium knows that something is going on. They are likely to make a move very soon. I think waiting might be a mistake, but she shrugs. I am no soldier. I am a killer. I defer to the soldiers in terms of strategy and tactics.
You think we can infiltrate that facility, Nassir? The four of us? While our forces gather and prepare for an attack as a diversion?
I know I can, and I know Thurayya probably can. He gives her a small smile. But I do not know about you, and I do not know about that hulking beast Ali. But I see both points. Waiting for Aladdin is a good idea because it gives us a better shot at fighting and winning. But time is also something we do not have, possibly. I think a small strike team to be inserted during the main attack is a good idea. And I can say I have seen both Ali and Thurayya fight enough to know our chances of success are very good.
Perhaps there is some way we can draw out some of their soldiers.
There is. We take a smaller portion and attack someone else. Let them come in. And then we'll spring the trap.
Somewhere close enough that it would make sense for them to reinforce from this main base.
Yes. We could harry them for a few days. If need be.
And then when their forces are not at their fullest, we then infiltrate and take over the base while they are outside of it.
Perhaps if we time it right, when we do the diversion attack away from the building and they come out, it'll help everybody slip in, and then we divert and spring a trap and turn into our main attack on the building, cutting off those who came out to reinforce their position on the outside and squishing them in like an anvil, all the while attacking the building.
If you can find a target of opportunity that is both close enough and important enough to draw the defenders away from this facility, then I say we go for it.
Thurayya starts looking at the locations she had found. Maybe there's a supply depot or a communications array or something that's kind of within range of the main place. What do you think? Is this a roll? Are we going off of the previous observation roll?
It's a dark side point spend to girlfriend.
Got to spend a dark side point to...
Yep. Two dark points. You can... I can just make it so.
Perhaps even to make it even more convincing, I'll lead the attack so you guys can slip in. And then we reconvene on the inside when I get the army going.
Yeah, my only question would be, is since this facility is incredibly important, what can we draw them away from? What would they be willing to...
That's what I'm asking you guys. It's a steep price.
Like I said, maybe there's a supply depot or just a mine. How about that? A mine really nearby?
Or a utility.
Oh, yeah. Some sort of plant that provides...
A mine or power plant would work just based on things that I know and you probably don't know.
But Ali would look up. I'll lead this attack. You guys slip in when they come out. You start on the inside. Once we spring the trap, we'll assault the building. We'll make our way inside as well.
A power plant is a good idea. They cannot hatch their deadly plans or operation without power, and it would force them to react. It is up to you.
I am not entirely comfortable with dividing us, particularly in this instance. I am skilled enough to survive this attack, but it would probably help your face, Nassir, if Ali was there for backup once we encountered resistance.
That is true. What is the worst that could happen? I get shot
in the
face?
You can send Mikhail.
I was just going to say, we can let Nine Flowers lead the attack. I think he's more than capable and has the experience leading these rebels. I think we should stay together and execute the mission as a group.
If Ali is not confident in his ability to be unseen, then perhaps he can make himself very seen and serve that purpose at the main base.
Yes, I could definitely make myself very seen, but I don't know if that would... I worry that would might make him realize it's a trap.
He is not one for stealth, but when we snuck into facility and Hakam stole all of this data, we had a scanner that allowed us to move for the most part unseen. Perhaps we can do the same thing again. Hakam and Ali are not known for stealth like me and Thurayya, but we managed to get all the way to the command center and download the data before things turned a little sideways. Perhaps we just, if it is not broke, we do not fix it and do that again.
This sounds good to me. Pasha?
Yes. This is an excellent plan. The two of you can be on point, lead us in. We'll stay back. As you clear sectors, we shall follow you. Till it goes sideways. And he smiles at Nassir. Then Ali does what Ali does best.
And then, perhaps, when things are in our favor, Pasha could convince anyone remaining to throw down arms. Rather than...
Absolutely.
...die pointlessly.
Very true. They can be convinced that there's no chance of survival. It is more likely that they will surrender and hope we are a most beneficent group.
And if they have any humanity at all, which she shrugs, I don't know these consortium soldiers, but maybe a few of them do. once they know what their leaders have been up to and what they have planned. Surely they do not all know that this disease is intended to be unleashed. Surely they do not all approve of genocide.
Ah! Thurayya, I like the way you think. And maybe that could be a distraction within the facility. I can have Hakam create a virus of sorts, override all their terminals, and broadcast the messages that we have. It might be possible that many in the consortium's employ on Algol could be just conscripted. People like you and me, just on the wrong side, not knowing it. Off-worlders who came here for a job. And they might not like what they see. And we might have a mutiny on our hands, which would add to the chaos within the facility.
Right. Even if there are only a few, a small percentage, that is chaos. That is something they will be thinking about and dealing with while we sneak in.
And if I can get my hands on some sort of broadcasting device and let my silver tongue play havoc, why not?
This is good.
Fine. Can start a rebellion on the outside of Algol. I surely should be able to start a rebellion on the inside of Algol.
Then we should bring in Mikhail and we should see how many men we can get together in the shortest amount of time possible. Some for the distraction and a few to help us once we have the base to secure it.
Yes.
I think we've got our plan, Bo.
All right, let me bring in Mikhail. All right, out of character, can you just summarize it for me here?
What?
It sounds like
he
to me.
He was watching TV.
Yeah, I'm looking up stuff. No, pay no attention to man behind the curtain.
Well,
it sounds to me that Mikhail's being the distraction, right? You guys are all sticking together, trying to get in there. And once you get in, Pasha's going to try to kind of hijack the communications equipment and foment rebellion from within. Is that
right?
Yeah,
I think we're going to try to create release some of the data to get chaos going just before we try to slip in, if we're able to hack into their communications at all. Or maybe we can as we get through Faraday barrier.
Yeah, I think for what we could do is maybe use Hakam right now to... To use Ibrahim right now to create like a virus, right? Like a data stick that he could load a virus on. And when we attach it to some... as we are kind of infiltrating, if we could get our hands on some sort of data...
Yeah. Yep, he can do that. He just couldn't do it remotely because of that.
Yeah, correct. So it's just we don't care about the systems, right? Unlike the last time we were trying to take over the asteroid base, we really don't care to preserve this place.
Right.
So if he can create a really nasty virus that we could let loose on their installation, that would also help from a perspective of them trying to fight that virus. Their communications are down, the surface-to-air missiles and all of that stuff, it'll just spread. And as it's spreading, it could just, on the TV screen show all sorts of images and the brutality of the consortium. So whoever in there is of good of heart will want to fight back.
Hakam can make the hardware with his talent.
Yes.
But Ibrahim is having a hard time making a virus. That's going to be... He can reroll.
How much dark points do we have?
I think it's up to 3 now, isn't it?
Are you spending the 2 to do the distraction?
That would be 5.
Yep. So, I think you're only up to 3.
Yep. So that would be... Oh, that 3 includes the 2 for the distraction?
Yep.
So okay. You'll be up to 4 if he rerolled.
Yeah. I think this is very much important, so yes.
There goes my face.
We don't have to spend dark points. We can just spend a face point.
Prayer, face point. Prayer modifier is always 0.
Oh, okay. Yes!
It is.
Got it. So, Hawkum makes the This plays both into the wheelhouses, right? Because Hawkum's is the MacGyver guy. So he figures out the hardware part of it. Well, Ibrahim uploads the software into this bad boy. And he says, it comes with Pasha. He says, here we go. Hawkum worked long and hard on this. And I not only have one for you, Pasha, because you may be killed, but you get a data stick. And he gets one to Ali. And you get the data stick. He gives one to Nassir. And you get the data stick. He gives one to Thurayya. Chances are, at least one of you will survive this assault. That's all we need, right? More beer to keep for myself.
Now, where do we need to stick this again?
Is that a compliment or a underhanded jab?
Not at all.
Any data terminal, once you get inside, just clear the Faraday cage. It should be just within the outer defenses of the base. I took a long, hard look at Thurayya's readouts. It's not going to be an easy assault. But, with Mikhail's distraction, I suppose you'll be able to make it with minimal casualties.
I'd rather die on my feet than live on my knees. We will get this done, and thank you, Hakam, for these data spikes.
Yeah, Thurayya pockets hers.
Well then, time to load out and ship out.
Yep. Mikhail kind of shows up on the communicator. This is Mikhail, Nine Flowers. Myself and my men are situated 10 kilometers outside the power supply plant and strip mine. We are awaiting your orders, Captain Khan. May the icons bless all of us on this day and bless Algol and its independence.
I will let you know when the time is right to attack. We are preparing for our infiltration on the facility.
Most it. And he clicks off. I will wait for communication.
Pasha goes back to his room. He still has the kind of light armor that he picked up on the first assault. You know, he kind of puts it on, adjusts the crotch area because it's still a little too tight there. Looks around his cabin. Ashanti, note the time when Captain Pasha descends down to the planet Algol. If I'm not to return, the ship is Akam's, as he is part owner. Do as he commands.
Absolutely. May the icons bless you on this day.
Indeed. With that, Pasha kind of steps out of his room, decked out. And what does he have? It's his weapon. A Vulcan carbine. And makes his way to the... thought we had a ship, right? Like the small one. What's that?
Yeah, the small one, you could kind of fly towards the installation and outside of it.
Yep.
So you're keeping both main forces back, both from the main installation and the diversion, and you're going to try to get in first before all this stuff starts. Is that right?
Yeah. I mean, basically the idea is to first get there and not start the attack till we're almost ready to infiltrate, right? Mm-hmm. I don't want it to start now while we're still getting loaded out.
But by the time we do infiltrate, we want a lot of them gone on their way out.
Yes.
Oh, okay, because you're going to start the Nine Flowers attack first.
Yes.
Got it. Okay, this is going to work out perfectly. All right, it's going to be 5 minutes. I got to go take a leak again. This is drinking a whole bunch of water, working out, Zypher. All right, I'll be right back.
I thought it was old people's tiny bladders.
Not bad. Prostate of steel.
You keep it nice and massaged, I'm sure. I'll be back too.
Cool, we can take a bio break. And I'll think of the billion beers that you can play with.
Some of us have healthy bladders and prostates that don't need to urinate all the time.
A lot of dark side points.
Yeah.
What can he do with the dark side points again? Make us reroll or give his enemies a reroll?
It gives the enemy bonuses. It doesn't force us to reroll, but it can make him get benefits, including rerolls, memory serves. This is the part where I open up the Coriolis book and see what knocked out teeth that crit number is.
Joke's on you. I have no teeth. Yet.
It's a denture. Just go full dentures.
Yeah, the several days we were on board, we couldn't get you fake teeth, so we just gave you some dentures.
I think he would have just pushed his original ones back in. Could have been all
picked
like
them up, put some super glue on it.
Is everybody back? Yeah.
We look like Mr. Wilson from Dennis the Menace. You know, Chiclets.
We've got that dark armor, but this is snow, so I think Thurayya is going to get some white spray paint out and start doing some white camo over the armor and the droid.
You got to have that urban warfare camo that's like the mix of the whites and the grays and the dark grays. You just gotta have the captain that's white, and then when you get inside, you take it off, and then you have your darker colored armor.
Well, that's true. But it doesn't make as good of a montage.
No, the montage is the, you know, each body part is getting the armor put on and weapons being holstered and...
Back.
You good?
Yes.
Everybody see this?
Yep.
Ali, what happened to your hit points?
Yeah, it's, I got a bonus.
That's funny. Put him back.
He prepared.
So you're going to have to, you guys have communicators, I would imagine. Pasha Khan, you're the general on the ground. You're going to have to like give commands about when to start the diversionary assault, blah, 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 blah.
Nassir has communicator 5, so if you want to lug that thing around, coordinate everything, you are more than welcome to it.
You can be the radio man, and Pasha can
I'm the RTO.
Pasha's not carrying anything on his back.
This is broadsword one Romeo to fleet command.
That's what my grandpa was in World War II, I think, or something. He'd do something like that.
RTO is just a fancy word for bullet catcher.
Yep. Nice big old antenna.
All right. What does it look like as all the forces are kind of lifting off for the respective parts, and we'll go ahead and kick it off. It's snowing out, of course.
Nassir is loaded up for a fight. His armor cleaned, his weapons charged, even his sword, which he has yet to draw on his back. And as he gets to leave, he goes to put his hooded caftan on and unfortunately puts it on backwards and the hood is over his face. And son of a fucking bitch! And he looks around and no one's seen it, thankfully, and he quickly corrects it, ruining what otherwise would have been a very macho moment, and then puts it on correctly, cinching it at the waist, and then walking out to meet the rest of his squad and ragtag army that will unfortunately bear the brunt of the consortium's weaponry, but paving the way and providing the distraction needed to hopefully allow the quartet to carry the day.
Thurayya is getting her probe ready. She's kind of painting it a little camo, and then loading up every weapon that she can reasonably carry, stashing ammunition and extra ammunition, stealth ammunition, regular ammunition, and various parts of her armor compartments. Finally, she also pulls out one of the white caftans, one of the warm weather, cold weather gear that she had been wearing, and covers up with that. Pats her droid. Good job.
Probe.
Oh, yeah. It's a drone. It's in the middle.
R2D2 sounds.
Good boy. You have served me well, and I think you will serve us well again today. Now let's go. And she goes to look for the others with the drone kind of trailing just behind and above her.
Actually, one of the shuttles comes and picks up the quartet on the snowfield. The pilot kind of steps off. All yours, Nassir. I won't say bring her back in one piece. I do not care about the ship in this instance. I care only about my home planet, and yours as well.
May the icons be with you, Nassir Amit, and the crew of the Crimson Wish.
It gives you all a salute as he leaves the kind of assault ship in your command.
Nassir nods and thanks, and may the icons watch all over us today. We will need their blessings and their protection. And thank you for this ship. I cannot guarantee I will return it in one piece, but I hope it serves us well in what is to come.
Captain McHale's men are in position, as is the main assault force. Captain Khan, please let us know when it is time to move. You are the eyes on the ground and have the best vision of the battlefield on this day.
They shall receive my orders shortly. Prepare yourself, young one. Today will be a glorious day. You will survive it, for the icons watch over you. And one day, long, long into the future, you will be sitting in a warm hamlet with your grandchildren around you, and you'll tell them glorious stories about today. And when you do, do not forget the name Pasha Khan. Now off you go.
He kind of laughs as he's heard the rumors about the Pasha's lack of humility. And all the rumors are true, and he trots off, leaving the ship to you guys.
Nassir gets in, doing a systems check, kind of familiarizing himself with it before they head in. Sitting down and kind of patting the controls, talking to it as if he would a friend or pet. This, attaboy, just get us there in one piece and we'll do the rest.
Asha sits in the co-pilot's chair next to Nassir. He checks his carbine, makes sure it's locked and loaded.
Tell me, Pasha, when is the last time you fired one of these things?
In the jungles next to Mikhail's base. But I must say it wasn't my shining moment. None of this is. But what must be done, must be done. I wish words could resolve all our problems. But sometimes dogs do not understand words.
If we drop enough of them, words will make them listen. They will hear when they see what me and Ali and Thurayya can do. I think your words will carry more weight and they'll be more susceptible to surrender, or better yet, cause a little bit of extra chaos.
At one moment, Pasha that kind of swivels his chair around and looks at the three of you. I have not yet failed in any endeavors I've set my mind to, and I do not mean to start today. But this is the biggest endeavor yet, freeing an entire planet. And I'm not nervous. I am giddy with excitement, but I would like to see what the future for Pasha Khan holds. But there is a harsh cold truth that none what we try today may come to fruition. If that is the case, and if Algol is to be my tomb, maybe even our tomb, And I tell you this, a lot of people have put faith in the four of us, and then they're going to die trying to give us a chance. If we have spent all our chances and there's no further thing to go, all I ask is do everything we can to destroy that place. Burn it. Burn it all the way to the ground. That in itself, there might be the freedom for your people.
I will do that if your mission or your subterfuge does not succeed. I will ensure that the last thing the Consortium sees is this place going up sky high, consumed in flame.
Very well. Onwards. Pasha gets on the comms. This is the Golden Child to the Snow Badger, calling Mikhail Snow Badger.
This is Mikhail Nine Flowers.
Begin your assault. For the glory of Algol, for the glory of its people. Leave nothing standing. Leave none alive. No quarter.
Very well.
You kind of hear the men shout in the background.
For Algol! For freedom! And the liberty of the demon store. Down with these Consortium dogs. These colonial pigs. These agency scoundrels. May they drown on the snow. May they be buried alive by the mountains of this planet. On me, before the nine flowers.
And you hear them all kind of start to cheer on the other end, and that is followed by on the other end of the thing, just you start to hear just the sounds of battle and people just dying. And eventually the other end of the comm clicks off, and you know that assault is underway, hopefully providing you with a diversion.
Yeah, I think we kind of wait for a bit to see if any reinforcements leave from this place.
Yep, they start to filter out more and more, start to filter out as you wait. They kind of exit out. I'm going to say by this time you've landed the shuttle. You can kind of role play what looks to me like maybe you've landed the shuttle over a bluff, and you're kind of looking out over the installation with binoculars, and you see kind of convoys heading out for the most part kind of towards the power plant and towards Mikhail's distraction. Every now and then, because it's only like 10 kilometers away, you'll hear these low explosions. Boom. Boom. And you'll see like bright flashes in the sky to the east of you.
Nassir kept the shuttle low to the ground to prevent any sort of detection system from spoiling their sneak attack or their sneak approach. He lands on the opposite side of a bluff, and then the group gets out, and he finds himself laying down in the frigid terrain, looking as the reinforcements slowly respond and make their way towards the power plant or the diversion attack, and he can see the explosions in the distance, and it takes him back to his days with Ali when he first fought against the Consortium and their expansion and exploitation of the Northern Highlands. And he thinks how it's brought him full circle. And it seems the Icons wanted him back on the planet to rid the people of the Consortium for good. And it brought a smile to his face as he looked at the people to the right and left of him and knew that he was in good hands.
Thurayya is obviously agitated and impatient, listening to the sounds of battle in the distance, wondering how many people are dying as they wait for the right moment. She's, to distract herself more than because they haven't already discussed it, because they have, I'm sure. She has the map or the visuals of the facility pulled up, and she's kind of comparing it to the angle that they are right now and finding what she thinks are probably going to be the best approach points to get through unnoticed.
Indeed, most of the points you head through, you see, you actually have to go down and up many trenches, concrete, dirt, otherwise. You seem like, oh man, you probably think it's pretty good idea that you went now and not later, because as we saw in that cutscene, the doc and the powers that be had been alerted to your presence, and they've been preparing for this sort of thing exactly. But to your benefit, they think your main attack is probably on that power plant. And so almost all of the way in is kind of is vacant. You find pretty easy going initially. At one point though, just kind of patrolling ahead of you, you see something just moving very slowly through the snow, walking. It looks like a solitary soldier. I want you guys all to give me an observation. Yes, an observation check.
Did I get any bonus from the drone? Because I didn't add anything.
Oh, yeah. Roll me a 2d6. Let's see.
You rolled culture.
It says you rolled culture,
oh.
Ryan.
Yeah, well, she just wanted to determine where this guy was from.
This man clearly has no manners. Look at the way he drags his feet.
Well, I got one.
Here's how it goes. Pasha, you're the one to see it first, okay?
Mm-hmm.
You see it first. You stop everybody. What does that look like?
So, yeah, we kind of walking two by twos. Pasha is next to Nassir, Ali behind Pasha, and Thurayya behind Nassir. And Pasha sees this figure out in the distance, and he kind of raises his hands in the fist and stops.
Thurayya, you pick it up second, and your new scanner on your probe picks up zero infrared spectrum.
From the sky?
Yep.
She looks back.
And you bet your observation too. It's moving like a machine.
Yeah, she looks at it quizzically at first, you know, thinking that there must be some mistake, and she checks the readings again, and then she says, "Wait. There are no heat signatures coming from. That is not a person. That is something mechanical."
Interesting.
Nassir, being more of a nomadic and growing up in a very spiritual clan, kind of does a motion across some of his eye tattoos, and that is heresy to have some kind of creature like that.
No matter. It'll die the same as a human being.
Let us hope so.
Yes, but
even as you talk, it just powers down. It seems to like activate for 30 seconds and then go dormant for 30 seconds. If you watch it long enough, there's a pattern to it.
Perhaps we can slip by because while I'm sure it can be destroyed, I can probably scream very loud and at least, you know, send communications to the rest of the facility before we take it out.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, let us ensure we know the pattern and then we will sneak by. I think it is best, like Thurayya said.
No need to roll for this one. Just role play for me, kind of how you kind of time it up and go and like either destroy it or disable it somehow.
Do we have to destroy or disable it?
You have to. You can buy it if you want.
Yes, yes. So I think based on what Thurayya said, Pasha would look at them. Patience. Thurayya, can you determine its pattern? When it powers down, maybe we could just flip by it without alerting it to our presence, like you said.
Yeah, she is looking, you know, she's already recorded its past few movements and power cycles and does some quick calculations. Yes, 30 seconds. I think we can approach from this direction. And when I give the signal, we go. We run past it. And she says, and go through this entrance right here.
Very well.
I will follow your lead.
Right behind you, Thurayya.
All right, so she kind of... They creep forward. It's trying to stay out of range of what they think its detection capabilities would reasonably be, and watch maybe a couple more power cycles just to be sure, and then waiting just kind of on the edge of her seat, nerves jangling. She sees it starting to power down, and as it reaches just the beginning of its rest phase, she raises her fist and, you know, releases her hand and heads forward at a run.
Take a step, 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 looks this right, left, red, glowing, machine-like, but no less malevolent eyes sweeping over the frozen landscape. Step, 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 tzz, power down. It's at that time you give the go-ahead to move. The camera pans up, fading away from the installation as white powder kicks out from behind your boots as you run from this thing, sliding behind a wall just in time for it to come back online and scan again. That was close. As you get closer and closer, you hear and see more of these things again and again, bypassing them. As you do so, the explosions in the distance get louder. You hear machine gun fire. You hear acceleration gun fire. You even hear explosions as small fighters are scrambled from a nearby installation and bomb Mikhail's men. Though many of those men die, it does provide you the distraction you need. And as you get closer and closer, you can hear the voices of the men
and women guarding this installation. Of course, they don't speak to their mechanical counterparts, but you hear someone who must be some sort of leader say, "They need more men down in the mines! You, it's quiet here! Go to the east! Fall back! There are transports awaiting you!" And as you look from behind this wall, you see, like, most of these men just are siphoned away, leaving only a bare bones kind of a defensive force behind, standing watch. Now I'll let you guys take away from there.
Okay, so can you kind of describe, like, are they inside something? Are they in a trench? Are they on top of something?
Yeah, the people on the brown are in the brown are down in the trench. Okay. And there's two of those kind of mechanical things kind of out front.
And we're behind a wall. School.
Yeah, you guys are not. You could probably peek up and see. Yeah. But you're in total cover now. Yep.
I think once we see the four of them leave, Thurayya is going to look at the others and say, I think that this is our chance. We can take out these four and the facility will be ours. Or at least we will have good access. I do not know if there are any more inside.
The distraction has proved effective. Hopefully, whatever these mechanical monstrosities are, we can make short work of them.
I think we should take them first. What would we focus on? Left or right?
Are these things, the B and C, are they cycling down to, or are they active all the time?
They're cycling down to. But it's all very strange to you. You've probably never
seen it. Do
they
cycle at the same time or at different times?
It seems random.
What about the squad leader? Is that one?
It's sitting there. It's sitting there.
That trench is not very deep, I'm assuming that. So it's not like the squad leader are not at our eye level?
No, they would get some like cover bonus, but yeah.
Okay,
you can probably see them down there moving, but more difficult to shoot them.
Sure. Okay, but it's not. But it's like anything that happens to these soldiers, they would immediately know something's up, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think we focus fire on one of the mechanical ones. Take it out. I think they're going to be. Well, we'll have a better shot. At the ones in the ditch once we take them out anyway. And we are at our best when we are focusing on the same opponent. Because we get that +2 bonus, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Very well.
Shoot the ones that are in the open before they can get in the trench and get under or get some sort of cover from our fire.
Yes. We come around, take the one on the right, because I think that will be the first one we have access to, the first good shot we have. This one, maybe?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All right. Do we need to roll some initiative, or what do we need to do, Bo?
Nasir's going to get into the prone and basically, like, low crawl to the corner.
You basically roll initiative as soon as... as soon as you guys are visible, because of their scanners and whatnot.
Okay.
So you guys can put yourself in the best position you can think of, then we'll roll initiative. Pasha's hanging back, I see.
He can provide command.
He can. Yep.
So how tall, you said how tall is this wall?
Yeah, you can look over. You can climb up and look. Yeah.
Oh, we can climb up the wall?
No, you can. You can.
Okay, I'll climb up the wall and position myself here braced against it.
Yeah, same with Pasha.
And if you're prone, I'll give them a negative two to hit you.
I was going to say it's negative one if you're firing from the prone, and that can be... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's negative one for them to hit you, right? Yeah.
Negative one for them to hit you, and plus one to you, because you can do the plus one fire support bonus when prone.
So prone is good.
Prone it is. Prone.
And the walls might provide some nice cover for armor rating.
All right. Tell me what it looks like. You guys kick it off.
Initiative.
Yeah.
Let's roll initiative, then that will kind of tell us how the nice. narrative goes.
For Algol, Nassir goes first.
Sim.
Higher's better, right?
Higher's better.
All right. So I'll take that 5.71 then.
69 decimal automatically goes first.
All right. Nassir. You get the first shot.
Nassir, kind of low crawling with his caftan still on, helping him blend into his surroundings, slowly moves to the edge and bringing up his weapon. He kind of helps balance it as he's laying down, similar to Ali giving that young girl shooting lessons just not so long ago. And he lines up on Mark C and goes full auto.
Don't forget the plus two for the group ability.
All right, so it's minus two full auto, plus two group ability, plus one for prone. So that's plus one total.
Yep. For this guy, you're shooting at?
Yes, sir. Well, luckily, I get to keep rolling because it's full auto, even though I missed a start. Do the same thing as last time, just stop after the second one. Two successes,
no ones yet.
Five successes, no ones. And we stopped at five successes.
All right, let me roll his armor. He gets no cover bonus. He blocks 0 points of damage. It only rolled 66 though, oddly. Oh, yep, he has less. Okay, yeah. So nothing. So what are you gonna do with the five? Probably gonna take him out.
Yeah, I was gonna say that's what I can't remember. I think my weapon's 9-4 damage plus five more.
Four damage plus how many successes you get? Five
in total.
So but it'll be four more, right? So the first one counts for the damage or for the hit, so it'd be eight total if you want to apply it all to damage.
Yeah, I think we'll do, well, I guess, does this take crits like normal?
It does not.
Then he's just gonna pump it full of damage.
Not like normal, but it does take crits. It's up to you. This is a different menace you've never faced before.
We're just gonna unload into it. We're gonna
unload into it.
Like a careless drunk frat boy, I'm just gonna unload.
Tell me what it looks like as you just start to just to blow it away, and pieces of its armor just starts to fly off.
Much like similar to his role, he lines up the shot and opens up, and the ground before it stitches up and kind of the recoil kicks back a little, and as he settles it down and regains control of the weapon, he just starts scoring hit after hit into the creature's torso, just kind of staggering it backwards as round after superheated round of matter tears away chunks of this machine.
Ali.
So the machine's still staying in there?
Yep.
And then I hate to focus on the same one. Just because the other one's going to be fully healthy. So I think he'll split and shoot off at the other one full auto.
Yep, I think you're going to be probably the same as him, so it's going to end up being a plus one.
What do you have again? You had the plus one for prone, was it? Or no, you don't
plus
get
plus one from prone, plus two for your whole group bonus, and then negative two for the full auto. So it ends up being a plus one.
All right. Then I also have another plus one for the advanced scope.
Plus two then.
Holy shit.
And I'll do the same thing and keep shooting until the second one.
Okay. That's five successes. Six, seven successes, eight successes you got.
Perfect.
Eight successes. Your damage to your machine, your damage is three. So that would be, let's see, let's roll his armor, see how many cancel out. Two. So, so five, six, seven, eight. Eight minus two is six. So you have six successes to work with. What do you want to do with them?
Oh, man. Yeah, I might do the same thing and just put it all into damage.
Don't forget, on armor piercing, you reduce the armor rating by two.
That's right.
So well,
let me see which ones. Oh, you know what? Last two sixes are the ones that that blocked it. So we'll say eight total, which means seven plus your base damage. That would kill it if you want to put it all to damage.
Yeah, that's what we're going to do.
It just goes down. What does that look like?
So after just a little bit after Nassir starts firing at this, the one robot, Ali will take aim at the other and just start unloading. Knowing that it doesn't know what this thing is capable of, he just knows he has to put it down as he lets go of his automatic Vulcan, I don't remember what I got, accelerator machine gun. And he doesn't stop until he sees it just utterly dissipate and collapse on the ground.
Godbiter, he's down in the trench. He says, he gets on the radio. This, you probably wouldn't see him do this, but he's like, reinforcements, we're under attack. But they are already, you can kind of see to the east that column that peeled off is just being strafed by Mikhail's men. So they're not coming back anytime soon. And so he levels his weapon at Ali, who just destroyed one of these machines, and he's got some full auto as well. He's gonna attack. And that's going to be with a negative one for your prone. But he's going to aim, which will give him a... Oh, you can't with full auto, so it'd be negative one. It'd be a negative three. There he goes. Primary weapon. -3. And he rolls a 2, and he's going to keep on rolling.
Who's he aiming at?
Me.
Ali. No ones.
Oh.
He's got a high capacity mag, so he gets a new... He's just going to ignore the first one. Ignores the first one. There's the second one. So 2, that's 3 successes. He's got a crit of 1 on this one. So he is going to hit you for damage and then crit twice and pick the best one.
Roll your armor.
Roll your armor. You might be able to block them all.
What's my cover bonus?
For the wall?
Yeah.
+2. Let's say +2. All right, so you're going to take 3 damage. And then I'm going to roll 2 crits. Let's see here. Here we go. Generate critical damage. 35. Gouged eye, stunned for 1 turn. And the next one is 61. Destroyed arm.
Oh no.
I'm gonna do 61.
Does he have machine gunner?
What's that?
Oh, I was curious if he had machine gunner. That makes him awesome. Like Ali and me.
Nope, he has a high capacity ammo, so he gets to ignore the first one. He can't ignore 2 of them though. Like you. So destroyed arm.
Oof.
It's a good thing I got a harness.
Yeah, it also says unconscious D6 hours.
Oh no.
Yeah, 61's terrible. Like you're gonna die soon. Don't worry, I'll save you.
Even if they're cybernetic.
Good question.
Yes. I'm not sure if losing a cybernetic arm would kill me or not.
Maybe not kill you. We'll see. I don't like to kill people, so don't worry about it.
D6.
Yep. Roll D6. 2. What's it look like? I'll leave.
See you guys in 2 hours.
I gotta carry you now.
Good luck with that one. You're gonna have to drag me. Ali, sees bullets flying at him.
Baller.
And then the next thing you know, this is dark.
Squad leader, squad soldier, amps up. You see him power up, and oddly, it seems these things kind of operate in a rotating fashion. You killed one of them, the other one powers up now.
Are they all robots? Fear is not, right?
No. You probably have your probe out in the background or whatever. Yeah. Yep, he is not. Gottbiter is not. And this guy's going to aim at Nassir, who shot at him. And he's going to do the same thing, full auto. Take you guys out. So it's going to be, you're prone. It's going to be a -3. It's a hit, and he's got a high capacity ammo, high capacity mag. So 1, 2, 3, 4.
Oh my gosh.
Well, if he takes that second one, he's out of ammo at least.
Yep. He's out of ammo.
Who's that against?
Me.
Oh, against your poor face.
And so he's going to what does he have to work with? 1, 2, 3, 4 of them. So he's going to do damage, so take... Well, roll your armor first. See how many you block.
I would say plus 2 for cover.
Yeah.
Yes.
Son of a bitch.
Oh, no.
Don't you have a reroll?
Yeah, I know, right?
You have some sort of ability. I forget. It's
for crits.
Ah, gotcha.
Yep. Let's see. I got 4 to work with. So, one. I have to use 1 to hit. So 3. Another 1 to damage. So take 4 damage, and then with y'all roll crit 2 crits as well.
Yep, 2 crits. So I'm down 4 hit points. I'm just that.
First one's a 65.
Oh no.
Well, I can move it to 56, which is not much better.
And I might even want to roll another one, because I'm going to keep that one. Let's see what the second one would be. Second one was 62. Destroyed leg. Aorta or leg?
Which one does he choose?
Well, obviously, you tell me. You choose 62, or what was the other one? 60 what? 60.
I'm going to choose aorta. The other one was 60. Severed aorta, whatever it said.
All right, severed aorta, so I'll change that to 46. Oh, well, not great. Pierced intestines.
Wait, was it 64?
I don't
know. It's the one with the aorta, 64, yeah.
64 is okay. Aorta, and then the other one he rolled was what, 62? Destroyed leg. 60,
yeah.
So, looks like I'll be taking... pierced intestines. Stunned 1 turn, then 1 point of damage per hour until the first aid is administered.
Not looking good for team. Pasha Khan.
Talk him down.
Talk him down. Why do we have to fight? Why cannot we be friends? Aim at the squad leader. So that would be what? Plus 2 because I'm attacking the same talent.
You can aim and everything since you're not doing auto.
Yep.
You can do plus 2 to aim, plus 2 for your group bonus, and then plus 1 for
prone.
For being prone.
Yep, so 5
plus five. Yeah, plus 5.
Oh, what?
Yeah, terrible roll.
I'm gonna pray. Oh, what's the prayer modifier? Same 5 again?
No, right?
No, you just zero. Pray to the icons and it rerolls it all.
Yes. 2.
Let's see how many they block. Because you might have a surprise depending on what happens here. Let's see. It blocks 1, but it explodes.
Wait, what?
Poor design.
Build it.
What?
You'll be able to figure out more about these things as you get inside or don't get inside depending on what happens.
Does anything happen to fear a...
This one goes inactive. This one is dead. As Pasha blows that up. So what does that look like?
So, Pasha sees Ali's hand destroyed and him collapsed into a heap. There he can hear Nassir kind of scream in agony as his intestines get shot. He looks at the thing that's the biggest on the field. He's not a field fighter, so he looks at for the biggest object.
It's like a giant armored box on a 4 crab legs, basically.
Yeah, so he's like, okay, that thing must be important. So he kind of with shaky hands he kind of steadies it and aims through the carbine at that,
He sees like there's some red glowing dots and he tries to aim for those, and he lets out a single burst. And then he sees it explode and he can't like believe his eyes. He almost like drops the gun before he can kind of catch himself, you like, and you know, he does a double take.
Thurayya, your turn.
Yeah, she kind of shouts, "Surrender or die!" And then she's gonna shoot. She's gonna take aim.
So that's a plus two, plus a plus two, plus a plus one, so plus five on you.
Yep.
Yep. I forgot to add his for being in the trench, his bonus, but I'll do it for him, for this guy.
That's a good roll.
That is a very good roll. You can try and re-roll the other ones too if you want to. Oh, I forgot to add dark point earlier, so it's up to four. What do you want to do with all that junk? All that junk up in your trunk? I know what I would do.
Jeez.
Well, let's see how many blocks. Let's see how many blocks, okay? So when you roll his armor.
Infinity.
It's armor piercing. Don't forget.
It's armor piercing, so it's a wash. So you get plus two cover bonus, so it's a wash, right?
Yep.
You only block two. So you have five successes to work with.
Two crits.
So that would be, that'd be two crits, and then you could still add two to damage.
Yeah.
And the damage for your weapon is?
Three.
So that'd be five damage. And we'll roll two crits, and you can keep that. You want to roll? Let you roll.
What do I roll? A D?
2d6. Oh. 2d6.
That's not good.
24?
Probably knocked out teeth.
26.
Oh. 24 is teeth knocked out. That's not even a joke.
<It is>. Or dislocated shoulder.
And 26 is a dislocated shoulder, stunned for one turn.
Well, I get to do one more quick shot from my drone.
Oh, yep, yep.
Yep. It doesn't get the aim bonus, but...
Hook shots at a negative two.
It's so... With the group bonus, that's just a nothing.
Yep, yep, just a nothing.
Oh,
that's wow. Two. You can roll another crit if you want.
Yeah, I'm going to roll another crit.
Let's see what his armor does here.
24.
Oh, motherfucker. Oh. Okay.
He's got a big exo shell on.
Well, still, that's pretty, all of...
Stunned for one round.
Is he stunned for one round?
If you go with the 26, right?
Okay, yeah, 26.
He's stunned. So... So he can't act. Nassir, you're up.
No, right. I'm done for one round with pierced guts, and I'm minus one more point of damage.
Ah. Ali?
Is... down, unconscious.
Death down.
Yeah, when I rolled the first time, I didn't realize you had to roll twice. One, the first time would have been time limit for death, and the second one would have been unconscious time. So that would be an hour for unconscious and 2 minutes until I die.
Okay, hurry up and take him out, Pasha.
Oh, man. Squad leader's down. Pasha's up.
Pasha's up again, so this is 5d with 5 modifier again.
Yeah, you just, if you aim and just shoot again.
Yep, all of that good stuff. Why does it take... Yes! Okay.
You have enough to crit him.
Yep, crit for sure.
Alright, let's see how many he blocks here. Exo shells are nothing to screw with.
No block.
That's just one success, so you can take 3 damage.
3 damage, okay.
Well, it blocks 2 points of damage.
He takes 1 point of damage, allowing him to do 1 crit.
Oh, okay. Yes, so 1 crit.
Yeah, he.
Is that how it works?
So he blocks 2 points of damage, meaning 1 point of damage went through, and you need one dice after however many are a crit. So if he got 3 sixes. Oh, no, I think you're right. You're right.
Oh, because he blocks. If he blocks two, he'd only have one left to work with.
So he takes three damage.
Takes three damage, right. Yes.
Just a question. Can you do an armor check when you're stunned?
Yeah, because it's just armor.
Yeah, he's dodging.
Yeah.
Oh, it's like that Mortal Kombat. He's just standing there and kind of moving around.
Oh, it's exactly like that. Finish him. Thurayya, finish him. It's your turn.
Right. Let's do this. Let's see what it blocks.
Three, nice.
Three.
Mm-hmm.
Block zero.
Oh my God. Bitch. Okay. Well, I've got my quick shot.
Oh, nice. Oh, what?
Oh my gosh.
Why is it we have like 80 dice and we can't block shit and this dude's got like 6?
Well, it blocks 3 points of damage. So it still takes, let me see, 1, 2, 3. Like from the first one, it was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it took 3, even if it blocked 3.
Yeah,
so it took 3 points of damage there. And here it blocked 3. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it takes 2. So it took a total of, 5?
Yeah, he's almost down. He's almost down. I believe Nassir can act again this round, though, right?
Yes, this next round. So
yep.
This round, I'm going to go ahead and subtract another hit point because I'm bleeding internally.
Ugh!
But isn't that where all the blood should be anyway?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, technically my blood's in my body.
Yep.
That's all right. I got a med kit. I can't remember what it is to medicate yourself, but
Kyle, you might save yourself or save Ollie.
Yeah, save yourself.
Hey. First, finish the fight, then fix your guts, and then I'll fix Sleeping Beauty over there. All right, so Nassir kind of regains his senses, his vision comes back. There's a sharp pain in his gut. As he knows something's seriously wrong, he puts his hand back on the pistol grip and puts his other hand on the back of his buttstock and leans his chin against it and fires again, full auto, hoping to kill this individual. So just a mod of +1 for being prone, -2, +2. And keep rolling.
2.
I think you got him now.
You got empty your clip?
No.
1. So okay.
Yep, so I do 4. 1 more. 3. Because if it was, I can ignore the first one with machine gunner. Oh yeah, no, it's.
Hey, keep running. Yeah, keep rolling.
Yeah, I'll keep rolling. All right, that's that. So
that's 4. Yeah. All right. See how many this exoshell keeps doing its work. No.
Finally.
Nice.
This might be his end. I'd probably just put it all into damage.
Yeah, we'll just do all damage because that's 4, 5, 6, 7 points of damage.
Aw, man. I also hope he's going to get away to be a nemesis. What's it like as you down him? He's trying to get out by the end. He's trying to get out of the foxhole.
as he starts getting the rounds coming in hot and heavy, you see Godbiter kind of panic a little and starts to try getting out of the cover, the one thing that was protecting him, and he just gets stitched up along the back from hip to shoulder and slides down back into the trench, the blood smear and the stark contrast of the snow around the ground. And with that, Nassir kind of lets go of the gun and rolls on his back. He's like, oh, I'm hit bad.
That's it for combat. I'm removing the turns. Good roleplay. Hello.
I'm gonna start.
He's gonna start. He's gonna whip out the med kit and break out the sutures and the staple gun. He's gonna try and heal himself.
Thurayya would run over and try to stop the bleeding over here or whatever, but she doesn't have any medical thing. That's just role play.
Yeah, Pasha is going to come running towards Ali to see how he's doing. And when he sees Thurayya is like trying to take care of him, Pasha looks over the wall to see if he can see anything in the distance.
The assault's coming. Is that what you mean?
Yeah. If anybody is coming, like, you know, basically based on this fight, is anybody else coming towards their location?
No enemies. No enemies. The enemies have mostly been ciphered away.
Okay, so then Pasha's going to try and do maybe an observation to see what the nearest door is or how to get past the Faraday cage into the installation. While Thurayya, Ali, and
all just kind of like invisible, just a Coriolis gray shield stuff, because you can just walk through it.
Okay, cool. Yeah. So then he's trying to find basically a door which they can kind of make their way towards.
Yeah, there's one probably 50 meters away, not very far away.
Cool. Ali, wake up! Ali!
Did Nassir do his medical thing?
Well, I'm waiting for that. I'm trying to decide if I'm going to use my talent to get my ass saved and then try and save Ali.
What do you want to do?
I'm going to use my talent to save myself and then try and save Ali, because there's a penalty trying to fix yourself.
Is he sleeping? Wake up!
I'm going to use my gambler's
talent. Ali, you can speak. I think totally unconscious.
Thurayya picks up his arm and shrugs what do I do?
So, yeah. Using the gambler's talent gives me 3. It gives me a critical success. So, basically... that's at the cost of the dark side point, because you don't have enough. So, as he's laying there, he kind of does an emergency release on his chest armor and the piece pops up and you see Nassir attach a diagnosed unit to his stomach as it kind of identifies where it's worse, and he pulls out something that looks like an oversized needle and just kind of jams it into his stomach and presses down and kind of making noises as whatever he did seems to be helping, and he finally pulls that out, and where the accelerated round had shredded his stomach lining, he takes like a suture gun and starts stapling it closed, finishing with some sort of spray to some sort of antiseptic to help before putting his armor back on, and he kind of gets up and stumbles over to Ali to assess how bad it is, hoping he's not too late.
You are, so D6 hours, so that's gone. And 1 point of damage. So you're good. You just kind of need to heal up roleplay wise. Sounds like.
Yep.
It's a crit success, right?
Yep, it's a crit success. So I stopped the bleeding, stopped the 1 point. Now just to regain hit points, I need time. So now it's time to fix Ali, because he goes over and kneels before him, and he sees the arm, and he kind of sees some of the sparks, but he knows it's a very serious injury, regardless of it being flesh or machine. And he begins his work.
Ali, what are you doing?
Ali's staring up at the sky.
Yeah.
Enjoying a nice view as he feels himself just getting a little tired.
All right, the med kit. I mean, I'm going to look that one up here.
So it's +2 to my medicurgy roll.
And you get a minus.
I'm not terribly familiar with. I think it's just I need to stabilize the injury.
Well, I know it comes with a minus. I think that's a -1 that's shown in that column, right?
Yeah, so it would be just a +1. Because, yeah, since it's fatal, it's -1 and then +2 for the med kit.
Med kit gets +2. Bonus for medical equipment don't stack.
Can anyone only be a +1? Assist, or do you have to have the skill to assist?
I would allow a +1.
So back to +2 for mod.
But you guys have to roleplay.
Yeah.
What you do.
I'm assuming that he's doing something to try to... Are we trying to reattach the arm? There might be nanites that kind of start the...
No, work. You're not going to reattach the arm. Nope. You just got to stop the bleed.
All right. Thurayya is just applying pressure. I mean, that's easy.
The arm basically, per the crit, is the arm is permanently lost. So if we want to say his cybernetic arm or whatever it was ripped off to the point where it met flesh and is now bleeding. You know, Nassir kind of pulls out something and then a short rod and puts a makeshift tourniquet as he wraps the material around the upper part near the shoulder and then ties it around the rod and then starts spinning the rod. So the wrap gets tighter and tighter, and he looks to Thurayya. Here, hold this while the bleeding stops, and I'll do what I can.
She takes hold of the tourniquet rod and holds it as still as she can.
And as he kind of looks at the stump of his arm, he looks for some sort of artery that is gushing the most blood despite the tourniquet and pulls out basically something to cauterize it as best he can. It's ugly, it's quick, but it'll prevent him from completely bleeding out. And he looks to Ali, like, I'm sorry, my friend, but this is going to hurt more than it already does. And before he even gives him a chance, he just turns it on to, you know, max and starts searing the flesh and smell it as he does his best to stop his friend from dying.
This is all on the table here. Here we go.
I cut
the blue wire and then I cauterized the red one.
So that held.
It's stable. Yeah.
And then it also takes away half my healing time as well. So whatever that is.
Do you have any one-handed weapons, my friend?
What counts as one-handed weapons? Would my accelerator machine go into harness that I could plop onto a stump?
I wish it was that easy. Here, take this. And he pulls his accelerator pistol, his own, from his holster, his thigh holster, and hands it to him. He goes, hopefully we will be in and out soon enough. Stay with us.
We just need to find a place to upload this. And she pulls out the data stick. There has to be one very close. Maybe even on the outside if it's in a, you know, an electronic door.
Well, if someone pops up in front of me, I'll still shoot them.
Yeah, we've entered roleplay space here, so tell me what this kind of looks like, because you guys are very, very bad shape. Make it to the edge of the installation, to the door. The door is open. You can step in and get access to computer terminal.
Nassir, despite the pain in his stomach, is you know, has Ali's body supported as best he can with one hand, and Thurayya, Pasha, lead the way. We'll trail as best we can. You can just kind of see a trail of blood from one of his boots as they make their way to the door, and he does his best to support as much of the weight as he can from Ali in what can only be imagined as incredible pain.
Thurayya nods. She still has her accelerator. Actually, that's long range. She pulls out her Vulcan carbine and has it out. She kind of takes point, making sure things are safe, and she says, Pasha, find the data terminal. I will cover us.
Yes. Pasha kind of flanks Thurayya. He has his Vulcan carbine out, and they start making the way to the door. Once he gets to the door, he's kind of going to put his back against it and, you know, crane his neck in to see if, you know, to basically check out if it is empty and no one around. If it is clear, he's going to make his way in and kind of look around till he finds the data terminal. The moment he finds it, he remembers Sakam's instructions and Ibrahim's instructions. He looks for data port and inserts the thingamajig that Hakam created.
Here goes nothing. Time to see if our boys did good.
Yeah, no roll required. It does what it's meant to do. The great in power, Hakam, crafted it.
So then the screen that's attached to the data terminal kind of lights up, and then there is, you know, like a lot of garbled, like static electric rain. And then it starts like cycling through images of enslavement of the Algol people, the vicious conditions in the mines, plans of to like extract every last bit and destroy this planet, and it's just cycling through. Is there a Pasha still looks around, is there any room or some sort of like intercom?
Yeah, I think attached to the terminal there would be a public announcement type of terminal intercom.
Okay.
PA.
So Pasha would kind of make his way, kind of look back at his group, them hobbling in into the room. He goes and clicks the intercom, and you kind of hear a buzz. People of the Consortium, oppressors of Algol, your time has come. Your evil ways will stand no longer. Your atrocities will be laid bare. The day of reckoning is here. I am judgment incarnate, and I'm here to extract it. Those of you who are hoodwinked by the promises of the Consortium that your work here was good, those of you who did not know what the true purpose of the Consortium was, you still have a way towards redemption. Drop your arms or take up arms against your fellow, for what is happening here cannot stand. If you are with me, then fight back. Mutiny against your captain and your leaders. Take this installation back and free the people of Algol. If you choose to stand against me, then you may start beginning counting down the minutes till you come face to face and I end your life. This is Pasha Khan, and I fight for the freedom of Algol. You have been warned. And then he clicks the
intercom off.
After he does that, Ali would look at Pasha. That's a good speech. Now come take this machine gun.
Me? What am I supposed to do with a machine gun?
Well, you point and shoot it. I can't use it, it's heavy.
Pasha kind of looks at Ali, kind of shakes his head quizzically, and then he... All right. Very well, then here, take my Vulcan carbine. It's a little lighter.
He already has the pistol in his hand. I'm not sure if you'll be able to use the carbine.
Oh, well, because it's two-handed, right? Okay.
Yeah.
Pasha comes over and, you know, he takes the machine gun and almost drops it. Do you expect me to carry this everywhere?
I'm going to need it back so don't break it. There's a harness. Attach it to your body.
Why can't you carry it? I jump on the back of you and I can fire it for you.
Yes, and Nassir to carry both of us.
We will be invincible. Enough jokes. Come. The fight has just begun.
And as that virus uploads into the system and starts to propagate, all the surface-to-air defenses go down. The accelerator turrets, the missiles, the Faraday cage, everything goes down. A lot of the soldiers that have fled to the east are kind of on their way back as Mikhail's men starts to mop them up. And you see kind of over the crest of the low hills surrounding the installation, just hundreds, if not hundreds of thousands of Algolians come over the ridge with weapons charging to the assault. Kind of over top of them are shuttles that have been equipped with rocket launchers and everything else. They're just kind of coming closer and closer, just laying waste to this installation. Except, of course, the communications arrays that you need.
Once the Faraday's down, I think we would try to get in touch with the ship to get in touch with Mikhail to let him know that... we've taken out their outer defenses and we're inside. And it looks like their inner defenses have basically given up.
You hear the sounds of battle near Mikhail kind of start to die down. And you hear his men start to cheer. We have been victorious in the power generator. We have captured the mine.
So that's why the defenses here went down, because the power generator, they took out a power generator.
That and the virus.
Yeah.
Wait.
Is there anything else?
I think we would do a sweep of the place to make sure there wasn't anybody important here, but I don't know if we want to handle that this game.
Nassir is, as they've uploaded the virus, kind of like slumps against a wall. I just need to rest a bit.
Yes, you look tired, but she kind of kneels down and pats his face. You look okay. That's what's important.
Yes. I think I'd rather take a shot to the face next time.
Thurayya turns to Ali and says, you you're going to be okay, right?
With any luck. But it hurts. And look at Nassir. But we got to keep going. There's no resting yet.
I suppose.
That's right. We can rest when we're dead.
That might be sooner than later for some of us.
He kind of grumbles as he gets up and he can just feel his insides are on fire and he's going to need some serious downtime if they make it out of this alive.
With that, I think Thurayya would take point as they find the next door into the facility and start to slowly explore it and take the surrender of anyone who is offering it.
Anything else?
Nope.
If there's nothing else, I'm going to use all five of my dark points.
That sounds great.
Excellent.
Arriving ahead of schedule, thrusters blue against space is an absolute behemoth of a ship. A destroyer. Twice as large as the Crimson's Wish. Three, four times as large even. And at the head of that ship is one pirate king. And at his side is one Alina. And as he stands on the bridge, he says to his second in command, "Give me a report from the planet. Your friend Pasha Khan has taken the installation. Consortium reinforcements have held back per our agreement." Aladdin Pirate King looks to his right, where a third figure stands, her lips sewn shut, a blindfold over her eyes. And then it fades to black.
I am going to take my arm off the ground and beat him with it.